My next guest, though, he knows an awful lot about this topic. The debate over the use of medical marijuana, it's been going on for more than a decade now in America. And even as some states have made it legal for medicinal use of marijuana, you have a huge resistance from the federal government. It's a stigma that simply won't go away. They'll favor the big pharma types, you know, that give them the campaign contributions. But when you try to talk to them about the need, the compassionate need for medical marijuana, you just reach a wall. You got Ben Pollara, he's a political consultant and founding partner of LSN Partners. He's involved in the fight here in Florida. Ben, give me your 10,000 foot. Do you still feel resistance by the federal government on this?
Yeah, and thanks for having me on, Mike. I mean, we still see the federal government going after these medical marijuana dispensaries all across the country. There was a guy in California who just pled guilty to a 5-year sentence, who's been fighting this for years and years and years. And as the country's evolved a little bit, they've taken a little bit of a softer tone towards this, particularly in states that have high levels of regulation with their medical marijuana laws. But no, it's still absolutely an issue.
Well, as you go forward in this discussion, Ben, what are your talking points? What is it that you try to distill and say, listen, forget all of the stigma and listen to some reason? What is the reason that you try to put into this argument?
The reason is medical marijuana helps people. People are sick, dying, suffering from debilitating illnesses. And myself and John Morgan, who's the chairman of United for Care, which is our medical marijuana campaign here in Florida, get emails every single day from people talking about how their lives are better and their quality of life is better, or you know, their mother or father or grandmother's last months on the planet were better because of medical marijuana. That's number one. And number two is people pretty universally agree that medical decisions should be made between a doctor and their patient, and law enforcement or the state should have little, if any, say in that. And if a doctor and patient sit down and decide that a course of treatment is the correct course and can help them have a better quality of life, then they should be able to do it.
Well, I have an advantage here, having known John Morgan, you know, for 45 years, a very close friend, almost from kids back in college. And I know that he undertook this because he had a mission. He had family members that he thought suffering unnecessarily, and his fight is a real fight. His fight is the commitment to a little bit of compassion in the way that we treat these people, whether it's MS, whether it's cancer, whether it is glaucoma. All of this host, this constellation of diseases that can be treated, I think this big push came from him because he wants to do the right thing. And I think most people who understand the difference between just, you know, the crazy release of marijuana everywhere versus a medicinal use, there's a big difference in the way you analyze these two issues, isn't there?
Big time. And I think you hit it on the head. This is about compassion. And one of the first things that John said to me as we were starting out on this campaign is, first of all, he related the story to me about his father's last days on the planet and how medical marijuana helped him. But second, he said, this is not about legalizing pot. This is about getting care to the people who need it. And if we're going to do this, we need to create a system that's tightly controlled and regulated so that it's not a de facto legalization.
What about the arguments on the other side? That, you know, you hear it all the time, that this is simply a front for expansion of the use of marijuana, that if we allow this medicinal marijuana to take place, then we're going to have it everywhere. And the next thing, we're going to have the mob moving in. And, you know, just this horrendous list of everything that can go wrong. We always hear that from the other side. Has that been the experience in other states?
Well, I mean, I think, you know, there's a number of states who have done this, and they have varying experiences from state to state. But for the most part, you know, medical marijuana has not had a major impact on a lot of these states. I mean, if you look at California, you know, and you had a caller earlier in the program, I think Leonora from California, saying that medical marijuana had gotten somewhat out of hand there. That has to do with how they built the regulations in the first place. You know, there's a lot of other states out there, like Massachusetts, for example, is just now getting to implementing its medical marijuana laws. And they have very, very tight regulations, which is what we're trying to do in Florida. I mean, this is, again, we're not trying to go out and legalize marijuana. We're trying to get We're trying to get it in the hands of people who need it and whose quality of life can be significantly improved by having access to it.
But nevertheless, you have right now, you've got the it's almost like the DOJ, you've got the federales versus the effort to get this done. You've got, I mean, it's really a war in some places, even where the legislators have gone through. They've said, look, we legalized it. We have a system in place for medicinal marijuana. We think we can control it ourselves. And then in come these zealous prosecutors. I mean, they just ambush the medicinal marijuana operation. They arrest people that for not crossing a T or dotting an I. It seems to be repeating itself time and time again. How do you avoid that?
I think you avoid it by creating a set of rules and regulations that really control the use of medical marijuana in the state. And I think if you look at the states that have passed this, the ones with the tighter regulations are the ones that aren't being bothered by the feds. Mm. California was the first state to pass this in 96 or 98, and they're the ones that have taken the brunt of federal intervention because, you know, they passed it in a way that, you know, opened up medical marijuana in a big way with very little regulation. And as a result, you know, you have people like Leonora who live in neighborhoods where, you know, there's more pot dispensaries than there are Starbucks. And you have neighbors complaining and law enforcement complaining and the feds come in. But in states where this has been done in a very measured, calculated, controlled way, you don't see that. And, you know, obviously the states, especially as the list keeps growing here with Maryland and Illinois and others, you know, passing or trying to pass this year. You know, there's going to have to be a meeting of the minds here between the state governments and the federal governments because, you know, medical marijuana is broadly supported by all swaths of the United States, all swaths of partisanship, Democrats, Republicans, Independents, and, you know, it's not stopping. So there needs to be a coming together of the state governments and the federal government to figure out how to move forward on this.
What do you make of this argument that, gee whiz, if we allow this to take place, that marijuana is simply, I mean, even in a medicinal setting, that it's going to get out of control and that's going to lead to the fact that it's a gateway drug that leads to harder drugs, it impairs driving ability, it injures lungs, the brains, you name it. I mean, if you listen to the folks that are trying to put a halt to the expansion of medicinal marijuana, you would think that this is just apocalyptic. And then at the same time, of course, they ignore the tens of thousands of people dying every year because of those drugs that have been approved by the FDA. How do you respond when you get in a setting like that or the argument that, you know, this is just going to create an unproductive generation of Cheech and Chong-like characters, unproductive stoners? I know you hear all that. What is your response to those types of arguments?
Well, I mean, I think those arguments are specious at best. I mean, if you look at the states that have passed medical marijuana and have them on the books, you don't see substantial upticks in use. You don't see substantial, if any, upticks in teenage and young adult use. So these are emotional arguments that aren't backed with fact. And I think your assertion on the generation of Cheech and Chongs, I mean, listen, you and Morgan grew up together in the 60s. You're both very successful, productive members of society. That was the Cheech and Chong era.
That certainly was. Look, I want you to respond to this. I got a tweet here from Tim Riddle. He says that he's an MS patient and they get relief from symptoms from pot. He said he'd try it if it were legal in Tennessee, but he doesn't see it happening. He said instead they want me to use a medicine that cost about $28,000 for 5 doses. Isn't that kind of the same story that you hear again and again?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Is he referring to, I assume he's referring to Marinol, which is which is the pharmaceutical version of THC, which is one of the active chemicals in marijuana. And yeah, I mean, we get emails, you know, every single day from people who say, you know, I was prescribed Marinol and, you know, either I couldn't afford it because of what you just said, or, you know, I took the pill because I have no control over the dosage. You know, the doctor gives me a pill. The pharmaceutical company makes it only in specific dosages. And I take it, and, you know, I would get messed up. I would, you know, I would be high. But, you know, my nephew came over and brought me some actual marijuana, and I took one hit, and I wasn't high, but my symptoms were relieved.
Yeah. What do you make of the real numbers? I mean, we hear, you know, there's 70% of the American public, you know, is good with medicinal marijuana. Then I hear it as low as 55. I mean, where is that number? What does the public really think about the use of medicinal marijuana?
I mean, you know, I'm not out there polling nationally. I've only looked at what's going on in Florida. I mean, obviously, I've seen the public polls that are out there, but I think those numbers are pretty accurate on the high end. And I think nationally, it's probably closer to high 70s, low 80s. But in Florida, you know, I've polled it a couple times here, and I've seen other people's polls. It's consistently in the high 60s, low 70s. People are very supportive of it, and it's not really a controversial issue.
What do you make of the Department of Justice, their position on this, and their unwillingness to even try to cooperate with these states that say, look, we've looked at the facts. The legislators, we've looked at the facts. We're going to allow this to happen. And nevertheless, the people who have the courage to go out and do it are victimized anyway. What do you make of that?
I mean, I think it's extremely unfortunate and misguided. Here in Florida, we've had huge problems. I know this has been a problem nationally, but we've had huge problems here with OxyContin and oxycodone use. And, you know, all over the state, you don't see it as much now because they've started to crack down a little bit. But all over the state, you see these, you know, back pain centers, and they're calling them pill mills here, but they're essentially places where you can walk into a doctor, get a prescription for highly, highly regulated, very dangerous opiates, you know, very, you know, similar to what heroin is, and walk next door and fill them. I've seen lots of people in my life, friends and family, whose lives have been destroyed by OxyContin. But it continues to be widely available here. But the federal government, for whatever reason, wants to direct their, you know, their efforts and their resources to, you know, to busting people who, you know, who have cancer and AIDS and glaucoma, who are, you know, trying to improve their quality of life a little bit by, you know, smoking or otherwise consuming marijuana.
You know, you hear this argument also, and it just seems like such an absurd argument, Ben. But it is that medical marijuana laws, that medicinal, you know, any kind of medicinal marijuana laws, they're going to contribute to this greater use of marijuana in the general population. By now, we've had a chance to look at that. I don't buy that, but that's the argument we keep hearing. What do you think?
No, I mean, if you look at the states that have medical marijuana laws in the books, it's simply not the case. I mean, it's just a false argument.
What's your next step in Florida? To try to get this to happen in Florida in about a minute we have left, what are your plans?
Sure. We are about to resubmit our constitutional amendment language to the Florida Secretary of State, and they've got about a week to turn it around back to us. And as soon as they do, we're going to be out on the street collecting petitions. We've got to gather about a million petitions to get the required number here in Florida, which is 680,000. So we are through our campaign, which is United for Care. It's www.unitedforcare.org. We are about to relaunch our petition drive, and you'll start seeing people out there all over the state asking to sign on the piece of paper, and I hope, you know, everybody in Florida listening here will do it.